Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city of our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ, the King of exaltation, may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the Lord bless your branches as you hold them up. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
With your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When Jesus and his disciples drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately on entering it, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone should say to you, 'Why are you doing this?' reply, 'The master has need of it, and will send it back here at once.' So they went off and found the colt tethered at a gate outside on the street, and they untied it. Some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing, untying the colt?' They answered them, just as Jesus had told them to, and they permitted them to do it. So they brought the colt to Jesus, and put their cloaks over it, and sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the field. Those preceding him, as well as those following, kept crying out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna! Blessed is the kingdom of our father David, that he is to come. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Dear brothers and sisters, like the crowds who accompanied Jesus in Jerusalem, let us now go forth into our church for the celebration of Palm Sunday. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Follow the altar servers, and I invite all of you to follow me.
Thank you. the human race to follow, cause our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross. Graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering, and so merit a share in his resurrection. We live and reign in the divinity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance, humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please be seated. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
The Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were to take place in 2 days' time. So the chief priests and the scribes were seeking a way to arrest him by treachery and put him to death. They said, when he was in Bethany, reclining at table in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of perfumed oil, costly genuine spikenard. She broke the alabaster jar and poured it on his head. There were some who were indignant. They were infuriated with her. Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you make trouble for her? She has done a good thing for me. The poor you will always have with you, and whenever you wish, you can do good to them. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anticipated anointing my body for burial. Amen, I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priests to hand him over to them. When they heard him, they were pleased and promised to pay him money. Then he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him, he sent two of his disciples and said to them,
go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a jar of water. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, the teacher says, there is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples. Then he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there.
The disciples then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they reclined at table and were eating, Jesus said,
amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.
They began to be distressed and to say to him one by one,
surely it is not I.
He said to them,
one of the 12, the one who dips with me into the dish. For the Son of Man indeed goes as is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born.
While they were eating, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, and said,
take it. This is my body.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them,
this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
all of you, have your faith shaken, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed. But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him,
even though all should have their faith shaken, mine will not be.
Then Jesus said to him,
amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
But he vehemently replied,
even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you.
And they all spoke similarly. Then they came to a place named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
sit here while I pray.
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
my soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch.
He advanced a little and fell to the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass by him. He said,
Abba, Father, all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me, but not what I will, but what you will.
When he returned, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray, that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. Then he returned once more and found them asleep. For they could not keep their eyes open and did not know what to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough.
The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Then, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with them, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him and lead him away securely."
He came and immediately went over to him and said,
"Rabbi."
And he kissed him. At this, they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them in reply,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I was with you, teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me. But that scriptures may be fulfilled."
And they all left him and fled. Now a young man followed him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body. They seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed him at a distance into the high priest's courtyard, and was seated with the guards, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and testified falsely against him, alleging,
"We heard
So, their testimony did not agree. The high priest rose before the assembly and questioned Jesus, saying,
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But he was silent and answered nothing. Again the high priest asked him and said to him,
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Then Jesus answered,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
At that, the high priest tore his garments and said,
"What further need have we of witness? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?"
They all condemned him as deserving to die. Some began to spit on him. They blindfolded him and struck him and said to him, and the guards greeted him with blows. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's maids came along. Seeing Peter warming himself, she looked intently at him and said,
"You too were with the Nazarene, Jesus."
But he denied it, saying,
"I neither know nor understand what you are talking about."
So he went out into the outer courtyard. Then the cock crowed. The maid saw him and began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
Once again, he denied it. A little later, the bystanders said to Peter once more,
"Surely you are one of them."
He began to curse and to swear,
"I do not know this man about whom you are talking."
And immediately a cock crowed a second time. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had said to him,
"Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
He broke down and wept. As soon as morning came, the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes, that is the whole Sanhedrin, held a council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
to him in reply,
"You say so."
The chief priests accused him of many things. Again, Pilate questioned him,
"Have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of."
Jesus gave him no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now on the occasion of the feast, he used to release to them one prisoner whom they requested. A man called Barabbas was then in prison, along with the rebels who had committed murder and a rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
"Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have them release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
"Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the King of the Jews?"
They shouted again, Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder. So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him out inside the palace, away inside the palace, that is, the praetorium, and assembled the whole cohort. They clothed him in purple, and weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with, and kept striking his head with a reed and spitting upon him. They knelt before him in homage, and when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed into service a passerby, Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. They brought him to the place of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drugged with myrrh, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots for them to see what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him, they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying, Likewise, the chief priests, the scribes, mocked him among themselves and said, Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani,"
which is translated,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"Lord, he is calling you on your side."
One of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to take him down."
Jesus gave a loud cry, breathed his last. Please do. The veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion stood facing him, saw how he breathed his last, he said,
Truly, this man was the Son of God.
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of the younger James and of Joses, and Salome. These women had followed him when he was in Galilee and ministered to him. There were also many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When it was already evening, since it was the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished member of the council, who was himself awaiting the kingdom of God, came and courageously went to Pilate and asked him for the body of Jesus. Pilate was amazed that he was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned of it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. Having bought a linen cloth, he took him down, wrapped him in a linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joses, watched where he was laid. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
There is probably no other Sunday throughout the entire year that is more dramatic and in contrast than what we just experienced. We first started with the first gospel, where the people and Jesus is entering to Jerusalem, and they're shouting with joy, Hosanna! And so we see all of Jerusalem praising Jesus, singing Hosanna, throwing their coats on the ground, throwing palm branches on the ground as they welcome him. They just didn't say the word Hosanna two times. Think of a rock star coming on a stage. This is very uplifting and powerful as they honor Jesus, the Messiah, coming into Jerusalem. And then just a few more lines later, we hear the crowd shouting, crucify him, crucify him. I never noticed this before, but today I did. The first crucify was pretty loud, but the second crucify, as a crowd, we were a little softer. Perhaps we don't want to be the ones who condemn him. We don't want to really be the ones who say, crucify him. We are one of his disciples. As the disciples experience that first passion, so we too renew ourselves every year during this holiest week of the year. Today we begin Holy Week. On this Palm Sunday, we are all invited into the mystery of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. And as we reflect on what we just read and proclaimed, the passion of Jesus, we might look inside, contemplate, have I ever abandoned Jesus? In that first passion, all the disciples disappear except for John, who remains at the foot of the cross. All the disciples are gone, nowhere to be found. They abandon him. Peter denies him that he even knows him. And so we ask ourselves, have I abandoned Jesus this year? Have I not listened to him and followed his way? Is there something I carry, a sin almost too heavy to carry? We are invited during this Holy Week, come to Jesus. Come to Jesus as we remember his first Mass, the Last Supper on Thursday night. Come to Jesus on Friday as we reflect once again on the passion, the suffering of Jesus. Come to Jesus in total silence on Saturday when
when nothing happens in the church, no sacraments, no mass, no funerals, no weddings, the church is silent like the tomb of Jesus. Come to him in silence, and he will come to you. As we celebrate this Palm Sunday then, let us ask Jesus, be with us, be our strength, be our hope. Help us to understand what it means to follow you. Help us to understand what it means to die to self and rise with Christ. As we begin this Holy Week, we do not begin alone. We begin together as a community, as a Christian community worldwide, to remember what Jesus did for us. In his suffering, in his passion, and his death, he poured out his divine mercy upon us and forgives us our sins. Let us be open to the powerful presence of Jesus in our life. Let us participate as much as we possibly can in the celebration of the masses and services this week as we draw closer to Jesus, who wants only one thing, to draw closer to us. Together let us proclaim, together let us proclaim our profession of faith. I believe in one God, the Father of all things, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For our strength, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate with the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Gathered at the foot of the cross, we offer our petitions to the one who never abandons us, no matter how difficult our hardships are.
For the church, that our celebration of the Paschal Triduum may renew and expand the faith of all those whom Jesus came to save. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For an end to the death penalty in this country as well as the rest of the world, and a greater appreciation of the dignity of all people, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the people of the Holy Land, that peace and goodwill among faiths and cultures that they long for may come to pass, Lord, in your mercy. For those who will be baptized and received into full communion with the Church at the Easter Vigil, that they may be strengthened by the one whose strength was displayed through his passion and crucifixion, Lord, in your mercy. For those in our community who seek a deeper closeness to the Lord, and that the liturgies of this holiest of weeks may move their hearts, Lord, in your mercy. That all who have died, especially George Purcell Jr. and Loretta Edwards, that they will experience the fullness of joy with God and the saints in heaven, Lord, in your mercy. For John V. Coyle, whom we remember at this Mass, that he will always share in the eternal banquet, Lord, in your mercy. For those petitions that we hold in the silence of our hearts, Lord, in your mercy.
God of eternal compassion, even when we feel abandoned and forsaken, we know that you are with us. May we know your presence in our suffering as we offer these prayers to you, for the one who suffered for us all and became the source of our salvation, Jesus Christ, who lives forever and ever.
Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, your Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners, and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration, we acclaim. To be reconciled, O Lord, so that converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation Christ has brought us, we entreat you, sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. For when about to give his life to set us free, as he reclined at supper, he himself took bread into his hands, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing your mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
The mystery of faith. Accept us also together with your Son, and in this saving banquet, graciously to endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from one another. May he make your church a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace among all people. And may he keep us in communion with Francis our Pope, Alfred our Bishop, and all the bishops and your entire people. Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together with the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and all the saints, with our brothers and sisters and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will shine forth, in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Thank you.
takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Please join in singing our communion hymn number 448, O Sacred Head Surrounded, hymn number 448.
Thank you.
Let us pray.
Bearers of these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
It's a wonderful tradition in the Catholic Church to take a sliver of the palm home with you today, and the blessed palm home with you, and place it behind a crucifix or the Last Supper, somewhere holy that reminds you all year long of the greatest love that Jesus has for us. And so at this time, I know a lot of you weren't able to come outside. If you just hold your palm up, I will come and bless your palm. We have a few very important announcements. Please see the bulletin for the days and times of the Holy Week Masses and services. Please be advised that scaffolding is being put up inside the steeple starting on Monday, March 25. Because of this, we will lose a few parking spots and the side street will be closed. Masses on Monday and Tuesday will be in the upper church. Our Palm Sunday bake sale is this weekend. Please stop by the parish center to see what we have. Also, you can pick up your Easter flowers and Easter candy at this time. There is some Easter candy available for sale in the parish center after Mass today. We're looking for a few volunteers to participate in the Holy Thursday Mass for the washing of feet ceremony, and so we ask you to please sign your name on the whiteboard in the back of the church if you'd like to participate and be a volunteer. There will be a regional Lenten penance service tomorrow night at St. Clair of Assisi Church, St. Clair. A brief prayer service will be offered at 7 p.m. and at least six priests will be available for confession. We certainly encourage you to utilize this time. The parish office will be closed on March 27, 28, and Easter Monday, April 1. The last chance for the parish-wide survey by the Catholic Leadership Institute continues until Wednesday, March 27. Please see the bulletin for information how you can participate, either online or pick up a hard copy by the statue of St. Patrick. We now invite our children to come forward with their Mass cards as one of the altar servers comes down with the basket. Lord be with you. Please bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross. We ask your prayer and blessing through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass has ended. Let us go in God's peace.
Praise be to God.
Saint Michael,
our angel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. Amen.
Singing our recessional hymn number 703, Lift High the Cross, hymn number 703.